So I did say that my Atom reviewing days are completely over, but however, I'm going to make an exception here, and this is for the GPD Pocket. So this is a pocket-sized 7-inch Windows 10 laptop. It's had a lot of interest. A lot of people have been asking me to review this one, so I've finally given in and said, okay, yeah, I will check it out, even though I did say that no more Atoms, but it will definitely be the last one. So it's powered by the Z8750. It's got 8 gigabytes of RAM, 128 gigabytes of storage, wireless AC. Apparently has a full metal build on it, full-size USB 3 port, and a 1080p 7-inch touchscreen on there. So you're probably wondering why I am not showing the original packaging and why this is a retake here, because what happens is I expose the CD key, which they put right here inside the box for all the world to see. Now, yeah, I could in post, of course, edit that out, but I feel it's just a bit easier for me to do it this way. So I haven't looked at it yet. I just saw that and thought I'm going to have to redo the video. So here we have the power supply. Nice and small. A US 2-prong, of course. I'm going to need a power plug adapter for that one. And that is rated to 12 volts to amps. And then a Type-C to Type-C cable. And in here, of course, we have the little laptop. If I can get it out. And an instruction manual here that's just outlining the specs of it there, you can see. So the battery size is 7,000 milliamp hours. So the weight of it is 504 grams, which isn't too bad at all. Definitely a lot heavier than a mobile phone, of course. Right, so the build of it, that looks a lot better than the GPD Win that I looked at and unboxed. So all metal the top here. Feels quite solid in hand. On the front, there's just a little ridge there to open it up. And on the right-hand side, we have all of the ports here. So this, apparently, this is an exit vent here for a little fan that's in there, just like the Win that was also fan cool, but it was kind of just blowing hot air around. There should be an intake. Okay, there we go, on the bottom, four rubber feet. And Type-C port, micro HDMI, and then we have, of course, 3.5mm headphone jack with microphone support by the looks of that logo, and then a full-sized USB 3 port. I will check and see later on in this video if it will power an external hard drive. Along the back here, nothing. This part looks to be plastic for the antenna reception, I would say, or perhaps just the design choice there, and no ports on the left-hand side. So it is missing for me one crucial port or slot, you could say, and it's a micro SD card slot. Would have been very handy on this. I mean, I know you do have 128 gigabytes of storage. Even so, I would have really have liked to have had that. But so far, yeah, very portable. Just have a look now and see how thick it is. Comes in at 18.41 millimeters. That's without the rubber feet there. This is the thickest part, really. And with the rubber feet, 20 millimeters, so 20.6 there. That isn't bad at all. So, time to open it up and have a look at the inside here. So, the hinge on that's quite stiff, but not bad. I like to have more of a firm feeling hinge. Last thing you want is to be all loose and floppy. So, the maximum angle it will recline, wow, it was actually a lot better than I thought. Goes almost all the way back, you can see there. And if you have a look at that keyboard, that actually feels quite good, very firm. So, the build quality, so far is impressing me. It's a lot better than that Win model. So we've got a touch point there. I think that's what you call them, isn't it? Like the IBMs, the Lenovo ThinkPad series. So this acts as like the mouse pointer. So using pressure there, I'll have to test that out when I power that on, of course. Then your left and right mouse buttons there. I can see a logo here for the microphone, but can't see any really input for it or hole. It must be just below perhaps one of these keys here, which is a little bit awkward. So they've made compromises, you can see here, with the keyboard, the layout. At least we've still got full-sized arrow keys, which is going to help if people, I don't know, intend to game on it or whatever. But there are, of course, some keys along here. The caps lock is very small. Shift key, quite small as well. But with the space and real estate, they've done a pretty good job here, actually. And we still got shortcuts for the audio controls there, print screen, which I always like to have. And yeah, typing on this, of course, isn't going to be so good compared to a full-size laptop keyboard. I've really had to shrink things down. Anyway, let's power it up and have a look and see how long it takes to boot up. And that screen looks to be fully laminated. Yeah, I think it's safe to say that is fully laminated, the screen, which is great. Okay, so it did take some time to get to this menu. I've got to go through the Windows 10 setup. So you can see the languages we've got here. We've got English, Spanish, French, Chinese, and that looks to be about it. Well, Korean too. And the touchscreen working so far all right. Let's run through that setup and we'll have a look at the device manager. Free available space. Okay, so setup was a little bit slow. As it can be, that Windows setup decided to also download some updates, so it had to reboot two or three times or something. And yeah, it was pretty slow there. Being an Atom, it's not exactly as fast as the Apollo Lakes either or the Core M's. So I've just put a couple of files on here to test out a few things. I wanted to show you first the screen, which looks really, really good. Now, fully laminated, 1080p, super sharp, and this is 100% brightness at the moment, which looks very good, not bad at all. And here we go down to 0% brightness, which to me looks a bit too dim. Too bright. It should be dimmer. Really, for nighttime use, I find that that's going to be a bit too bright. And it's 25%, 50, 75, then 100 there. Now, you'll notice that down in the taskbar, my wireless AC range is quite poor there. So I feel that this is going to probably be the biggest con. This is just my first impressions here. But it looks like because it's a full metal body and a very small device, the wireless reception, the range is just not really that good. So far, that's going to be my biggest complaint, just looking at it. So here I have the device manager. Just wanted to show you quickly that the internal storage is a Samsung. This is the DJN-B4R. Have a look on the internet if you want to find out more information on that. And the wireless is Broadcom wireless AC. So that's good to see wireless AC on an Atom device here, especially at this price range. It's got to be wireless AC, I feel, so we can at least maximize on those speeds there. But again, yeah, that range is going to be a little bit of concern there and just how well it's going to perform. I'll test it out in my full review. So the processor, of course, is 4 threads. That's the Z8750 and nothing else really of interest there to show you. So I am benchmarking that drive. And it's just finishing up now. So yeah, I can see from that that it's eMMC 4.5 spec, but those speeds decent. Those reads are quite good. And the Samsungs normally are. So it's not one of those cheaper Bwin drives, which can sometimes cause a few issues. So the memory, we've got 8 gigabytes of RAM, but I've noticed a con and both a pro here. First, I'll start with a pro, that it's two slots there. So that means it's going to be dual channel. That will help the integrated graphics. However, the speed, fastest supported speed is 1600 megahertz. This is 1066. Now, normally with these devices on the Atoms, you could go into the BIOS and set higher speeds there. So hopefully I'm able to tweak it up to the next level and we'll get slightly improved performance there, but maybe they've toned it down for a reason, for battery life, for heat or something like that. And Windows. Have a look and see that it seems to be fully activated and this is the latest image they are using. So the vent on the right side, I can feel a little bit of air coming out of this, so it's definitely doing its job. But whether or not that's going to stop it from thermal throttling, I have to check out later. I need to do a lot more in-depth tests, gaming and things like that, just to see what's going to happen there. But a bit of heat coming out and I can feel a little bit of heat on the underside too that's transmitting through the rear base. Now, these ports here, I have tested this. This is a proper type C port, so it's supporting both charging data and the good thing here, display out. So that means it can be used as a docking port and with one of these type C hubs. This is one I've got here from Havit and it works well. 1080p maximum resolution. That's all that you can get out of the cherry trails there. So they're not supporting higher resolutions up to 4K like you get with the Apollo Lake. So it's a little bit of a shame they didn't use that CPU in this particular model. And just to confirm that the USB 3 port, yes, will indeed power a 1 terabyte external hard drive. Keyboard is going to take some time to get used to typing on. Right now, I just did a typing test before, and I noticed the biggest problem for me is the space bar. I've been tapping the track pointer by mistake, and it just seems quite awkward. It's very cramped, so I would not be wanting to type out a massive novel on this thing. that's definitely not going to work. You're going to end up probably throwing this out a window if you do that. But of course, they've made compromises, understandably, with this kind of size. And also, the track pointer is a little fidgety at times. Now, you get used to it. I'm going to need a bit of practice. And I found that also trying to click the left and right mouse buttons, that sometimes I would end up clicking those two space bars there. So the keyboard's cramped. We don't have a touchpad on here, but we have a touchscreen, of course. However, I found that it's a little tricky to use because of the size here. Now, I can increase the Windows 10 scaling to help, but at the moment with the default scaling, we're 1080p at 7 inches, remember, that is very small. It is a little difficult sometimes to get things to minimize or maximize. And overall, it's just not as accurate. You're going to have two or three attempts at times to click things. So there are speakers located just down here. There is a little grill inside here, and the sound transmits upwards, which is good. I mean, you're not going to be blocking it if you happen to use it on your lap or anything. So let's have a listen to how those speakers sound. All right, so there is the tiniest hint of bass. It's almost non-existent, but there's a little bit there. Mid's okay, tiny little bit of treble. They're not wonderful sounding speakers. However, I will give them this, that these speakers sound a lot better than some of the tablets I have reviewed that have terrible speakers. It's good to see they are a little bit louder. Now, it comes out to be about 83 decibels. Now, ideally, I like to see around 90, but I find that for such a small device, the speakers are sufficient. So some bad news here when it comes to increasing the RAM speeds here. The advanced setting menu in the BIOS is completely locked out to us, so we're not able to change that. Right now I've got Linux Manjaro build number 17 plugged in right here. Let's have a look and see if at least I can boot this from the boot menu here in the BIOS. And yeah, it looks like it's going to work. However, the screen is still not displaying the correct way up. Hopefully that will change. So it took a long time to boot up. I'm talking about 4 or 5 minutes. And this is as far as I've got here. The touchscreen is working. The pointer also works. So that's good news. And it looks like there's going to be a few little settings and things that need to be tweaked. So you're going to have to invert the screen around and mess about with all of that. But it runs it, which is the main thing here. So here's a quick size comparison. So yes, it will fit in at least my large pockets that I have because I'm used to carrying around a 6.4 inch mobile, which is my Xiaomi Mi Max here. You can see the GPD pocket isn't really that much bigger. Of course, it's a lot thicker. It means it's quite bulky, but yeah, it is possible to put this in a large jacket pocket or large pants that have large pockets. Now look at the internals, very well done here. I do like this, and this is quite funny to me actually to see this on here. A copper heat transfer pipe and the cooling fins on such a small little device here. It looks good. They've done a really good job. I'm very pleased with the build quality, the internals here. You can see the battery cell there, which is 7,000 milliamp hours, and the hinge screwed in, and the dual antennas which go along the bottom here and seem to connect just to this part here. So that is probably explaining why the wireless reception on this does not seem to be very good at all. At least my initial first impressions of it are. So the GPD Pocket clearly isn't a device for everyone. It's a very niche market here, tapping into something ultra portable that people want. A Windows 10 laptop that they can take anywhere. So the design of it is a massive step up from the Win. The Win I had issues with mine, and I threw my towel in on the review because the keyboard just stopped working. I just gave up on that and thought that's enough, and I posted that one back to China to get my refund. I didn't like that at all because that can happen to any device, of course, that you can get lemons out of China, but so far this unit is really good. So the positives, build quality is excellent, the materials used, the travel on the keyboard keys is great, no flex. And it's got a little fan in there and very good internals. The screen, fully laminated, nice and bright, super sharp. However, being 7 inches, I find that sometimes it is a little hard to use it because it's just so tiny. It's going to take a lot of adapting to get used to typing on this keyboard and using the pointer as well. I will probably try and use touch when I can, and then the pointer for the more finer controls there. At least we do have that option in there. Design-wise, they've made a couple of choices I don't really understand. The biggest being, why is there no front-facing webcam on this? I feel for your video calls like Skype, you'd want a webcam on this, and it's a real disappointment. It doesn't have it for me personally. It could also do with a micro SD card slot, but we've got 128 gigabytes of storage on this. But my biggest area of concern so far has to be the wireless performance. The range of it I've noticed to be pretty much terrible. It's not that good at all. It's struggling. Other laptops and devices I have would have at the moment full strength. This is only getting one bar, and I do believe because it's all that metal design and the fact that the antennas, when the lid is up like that, are being blocked because it's right here, and having the metal in there, that's reducing the reception, the signal strength is dropping, and I'll need to test that out more, but really not too happy with that. So overall, is this a device for you? Well, it depends. Maybe you're someone that wants a super tiny, the world's smallest Windows 10 laptop. This is for you. The price as well is another big con. I mean, this is expensive. This is selling for about 480 to 500 US. That's a lot of money, I feel, for a dated Atom chipset. Even though you do have 8 gigabytes of RAM, it's got the Type-C on there. Thanks a lot for watching this preview here. And I do hope to catch you back in the channel soon with the full review of this model.